came back. Not that you noticed, although I did tell you, so it's less of a secret. Okay. So, we are going to continue with the next chunk of assessment. Projective tests this time. And these kind of build on implicit tests. Oh yeah, this time, welcome back. I'm here. And this time we're gonna cover projective tests, which kind of are similar to the thinking of implicit association tests, but not exactly the same. So, okay, awesome. So what are projective tests? So the theory here, let's tell you what it is. So a test presents a person with like an ambiguous stimuli, that's our definition of projective test here, and asks him or her to describe what is seen. The person may or may not be aware of their inner processes, but the idea is that your answers reveal inner psychological needs, feelings, experiences, thought processes, or other hidden aspects of the mind. You know, I've got lots of cool projective tests because of my psych testing class. Like, I've got a full set of Murray's. COVID brain is kicking in. The TAT. I've got a whole set of the TAT. I've got a full nice PDF version of the Rorschach, and I'm going to talk to you more about these specifically in a second. So I think I should just go to the next slide so you can see like more. I get ahead of myself if you have not figured that out yet. Okay, so yeah. Subjects are given a visual prompt and asked to interpret the image. These interpretations are assessed by a clinician, and in many cases, there's like a classic scoring rubric to like how to interpret what they found, like the most common ones. So the two most popular projective tests are the thematic apperception test, the TAT, and it's about, like, the idea is you tell a story about drawings of people and ambiguous events, and this measures your implicit motives and reflects what people want. Like, these, my props are in the lab. Damn. I got some really cool data visualization, like, just visualization books that like show like a nice high quality images of these that I like to bring as props. Ugh. Sorry. Okay, so we're gonna have to work without the props today because I'm an idiot. And I also know that you wanna get these videos out so you can work on them when there are lulls in your other classes. So that's the thematic apperception test. There's an adaptation of it that's called the draw a person test, or not really an adaptation, kind of. It's a nonverbal test of intelligence or emotional problems in kids ages 5 to 17. There's a 1980s update that's got, like a diverse, it has non-white figures, which was a big thing in the 80s. Like, that was, like, because kids are more likely to be able to relate if the person that they're, like, supposed to describe looks like them. Like, their reliability and validity, predictive validity, like, shoot up. It's awesome. And I have them. And so, like, there are different, like, complexions to, they're kind of horribly described, like, well, super 1980s level described of, like, kind of using like one ethnic group to kind of capture anyone with that general complexion. So it's, and please don't take this out of context. Like they have the, like a, I think it's a Puerto Rican group. And I'm like, come on, dudes. Like, not everyone who is like, not, who is dark-ish, who is not like super pasty or like super dark, falls into this magic like middle brown group. I don't know. They were trying. It was the 80s. Like, we have to appreciate the context. Like, this was a really novel thing to like have like non-white prompts. And I will try and remember to bring them to like kind of the little discussion classes that I'm hosting for the blended class, but there is no guarantee. Also, like, they're good disease vectors. Okay, that's enough about the draw person. Now the other test, and the guy who's the stern looking guy in the slide here, who's not me, the other person, the dude, is Rorschach. Like the youngest picture I could find of him. And the Rorschach test is that classic inkblot test. And this is from the 1920s, Murray's from the 50s. Like, these are super old tests, like early test days. And Herman Rorschach, that guy. And here's one example, like, this is Rorschach test plate. It's like, these are all in the public domain now, which is why, like, I can present them. Because these tests are usually super copyrighted, and they will sue you if you even think about making them available to other people. And they also, like, require major levels of licensure and things like that. Which is such a pain. But yeah, so the Rorschach, this is, Rorschach Psychodiagnostics Plate 2. And various studies have kind of identified, like, what are the most common popular response. And so, like, there's a study by Beck that says the most popular response is two humans. Petrovsky says it's four-legged animals, and 34% focused on the gray parts. And Dana, which is a French sample, which, again, this is novel if not using American or British samples, found that animal was the most common kind of response, and in that animal group, it was dog, elephant, or bear, and about half of this respondents focused on the gray. Now, the description with this card, sorry, I have to kind of move my couple things around to read it. It's a big wall of text. I'm going to read it here. And you can find these descriptions, like, on Wikipedia in nice detail. On the red details of card two, and these are the prompts that come with the packet. The red details of card two are often seen as blood and are the most distinctive feature. Responses to them can provide indications about how a subject's likely to manage feelings of anger or physical harm. The card can induce, quote, this is all in quote, but I want to emphasize this last little point here. Because it's aggregate. The card can induce a variety of sexual responses. Yeah. And there's no detail about what those sexual responses is, which I appreciate personally because I don't really want to know. How Rorschach defined that term. But there's a lot of, like, it's all about sex, like, for Freud. We're going to have fun with that lecture. So much awkward discussion for me. So this slide for now, the Rorschach Diagnostic Plate 2 may look extra familiar to a handful of you that may have played this, the Fallout New Vegas game, map of, or is this is one of like the early like visual prompts of how, like, when you pick your character, and it's inspired from the Rorschach. Now I'm going to show you a couple more cool slides just because I think they're neat and tell you what the most common responses are. So here is Rorschach Diagnostic. Oh, I lied. I'm apparently only going to show you a handful. The Rorschach Diagnostic Plate 10. The most common responses, according to Beck, are crab, lobster, spider, and the blue part of the spider. I cannot pronounce this name. I should be able to if there was any like genetic component to pronouncing Eastern European names. Apparently there's, I missed it. Notice that crab was really common, 37% of focused on spiders and really honed in on the blue. Those that like focused, another like 30-ish percent focused on a rabbit head, which I don't know if you can really see here. It's that light green splotch at the bottom. I think this is it. Other kind of foci included caterpillars, like, and worms and snakes. And the snakes are like the deep green, which I think is here. The colorful ones look really cool, but I don't know how well they'll translate on your screen. Now the French sand, like I don't have any data about how the French Dana paper like reported. Okay, projective test. Here's a TAT card, TAT. It's in your book. It's an ambiguous stimuli, and so like you could interpret this as this guy is stopping this lady from leaving, and maybe that indicates that you fear leaving. I'm not trained in the TAT. We have some faculty who are. It's really cool. Debbie Best is trained in it. Or it could be that he's, like another more optimistic interpretation is he's helping her sit down and kind of guiding her to a chair or something like that. It's ambiguous, but kind of written in a way that like can, that ambiguity like gives you multiple options. So what do people do with these projective tests? They're kind of an analysis of the content of the stories, the letters, speeches, all that other stuff. And they're mostly used by clinical psychologists. They provide behavioral data in a way, like, okay, it's kind of a little bit of mix of self, a little bit of self, because you're like recording your information, but it's kind of more narrative and story-like and very qualitative and subjective. There are a lot of disadvantages to projective tests. I'm going to talk about the advantages soon, I promise. There are some. Otherwise, I wouldn't include the section at all and be like, projective tests be old. But no, they have some uses. The validity of them is, evidence is pretty scarce. They're expensive. Like, they require training and they require a one-on-one with a, like, trained clinician. And so you have to, like, be either a clinical psychologist, a clinical psychiatrist, or have done like a master's and like have been super trained. They're also like, that's just the like interview, like the one-on-one. Then there's multiple scoring methods, and doing those requires like multiple people to like rate and evaluate them if you want there to be like any sense of like them being useful. So, and that's all just like the practical stuff. A psychologist can't really be sure about what they mean because they're subjective. Like, answers can be interpreted differently by different people, even when you have multiple raters. Like, there's a lot of overhead. Often there are way less expensive tests that work as well or better. So typically people use the cheaper, better one. There are some advantages, I swear. They're good for icebreakers, similar to how like the Myers-Briggs and some of those kind of really popular but not super scientific tests are like used in consulting and in companies and stuff like that. They're good for breaking the ice. So some skilled clinicians, and those tend to be the people that use them, and that's why they're popular. So maybe it's like you're able to use them to establish rapport with your client. And also because people really expect to see these because movies, and so they get weirded out if you like don't, or they even ask for it. So you're like, okay, if this helps you feel more comfortable. And so it's a way to like talk to them and like facilitate conversation and ask questions and just get them to trust you, because that's a really important aspect of being a clinical psychologist, according to my clinical psychologist friends and colleagues. And so, like, you can use this information to, like, get other stuff out that you wouldn't see, like, in a regular test. Or, like, no regular test was going to ask. So, for the most, the two tests that have the most kind of useful oomph to them, like, that are worthwhile, for for the most part, are the Rorschach and the TAT, which is why I talked about them. So the Rorschach is used by 82% of clinicians, at least on occasion. And it may actually be pretty decent for predicting suicide attendance, like for predicting suicide, or attendance at treatment sessions, or commitment to a mental hospital, like only under, but those are really only under like really specific clinical settings, which typically is like where the scoring is developed. So they can be useful for certain outcomes, but there's not a, and there are certain scoring methods that are more effective, and those scoring methods were developed in the same clinical settings that they're most predictive of. So inpatient hospitals and outpatient, like they're very, very specific things. Now, the TAT's got a shorter form, which is the picture story exercise, which is pretty decent. And also a little less reliable, as we saw. So there's some areas where there is some incremental validity that help like above and beyond other tests, beyond like the easier and simpler tests like the MMPI. Now, how do you evaluate these? So people score differently on projective and objective measures. We'll talk about objective like right after this. Those are like the not Rorschach-y type tests. So like you can get different scores of the same attributes, that tests are designed to measure the same attributes. And so it's possible that they measure different things, kind of like projective tests kind of line up with implicit association type tests, where they measure like what people want versus like the explicit, like which is more what objective tests are, like how motives are expressed, kind of like immediate versus like controlled deliberate response. And they also predict different outcomes, similar to the IAT, where the implicit version predicts like more like snap judgment-y type things versus the explicit, which predicts things that like you can take a little bit of time and don't have to like make snap decisions. So like the need for achievement can be like predicts both like math scores for like more implicit things, but they also predict when you measure it explicitly like volunteering for leadership positions. Cool. I'm mindful that like these get long and everybody gets antsy because you're staring at screens all day. So I'm breaking this up. Next time we are covering objective tests, which are the kind of the opposite of projective. Like, so these are the two chunks. So I will see you in the next video. Thanks for watching, and if I were a YouTuber, I would ask you to like and subscribe and hit the bell icon. You don't have to do that. I disabled comments and like, you're welcome to, but like, I'm okay. I got a nice job. I don't need like, I'm not going to monetize my channel. You can quote me on that. Okay, so next time, objective tests. Bye-bye.